The Holy Eucharist. The Holy Eucharist had for you many joys and advantages when you were able to participate in this sacrament of love, but now you're deprived of it for being defenders of truth and justice. Your advantages are the same, for who would have dared approach this fearsome table if Jesus Christ had not given us a precept, and if the Church, which desires that we fortify ourselves with this bread of life, had not invited us to eat it by the voice of its ministers, who reclothed us with a nuptial dress. All was obedience, but if we compare obedience by that which we are deprived of with that which led us there, it will be easy to judge the merit. Abraham obeyed in immolating his son and in not immolating him, but his obedience was greater when he took the sword in his hand than when he returned it to his scabbard. We are obedient in going to communion, but in holding ourselves from the sacrifice, we are immolating ourselves. Quenched of the thirst of justice and depriving ourselves of the blood of the Lamb, which alone can slake it, we sacrifice our own life as much as it is in us to do. The sacrifice of Abraham was for an instant. An angel stopped the knife. Ours is daily, renewing itself every day. Every time that we adore with submission the hand of God that drives us away from his altars, and this sacrifice is voluntary. It is to be advantageously deprived of the Eucharist to raise the standard of the cross for the cause of Christ and the glory of his Church. Observe, my children, that Jesus, after having given his body, found no difficulty in dying for us. There is the action of a Christian in the persecutions. The cross follows on from the Eucharist. Let not the love of the Eucharist drive us away from the cross. It is to arise and make glorious advance in the grace of the gospel, to go out from the cenacle, to go to Calvary. Yes, I have no fear in saying it. When the storm of the malice of men roars against truth and justice, it is more advantageous to the faithful to suffer for Christ than to participate in his body by communion. I seem to hear the Savior saying to us, "Do not be afraid to be separated from my table for the confession of my name. It is a grace I give you which is very rare. Repair by this humiliating deprivation that glorifies me all the communions which dishonor me. Feel this grace. You can do nothing for me, and I put into your hands a means of doing what I have done for you, and to return to me with magnificence that which I have given you is the greatest. I have given you my body, and you give it back to me, since you are separated from it in my service. You give back to the truth what you have received from my love. I could not have given you anything greater. Your gratitude matches by that the grace I have given you, the greatness of the gift I made to you. Console yourselves if I do not call upon you to pour out your blood like the martyrs. There is mine to make up for it. Every time that you are prevented from drinking it, I will regard it the same as if you had spilled yours, and mine is far more precious." So that is how we find the Eucharist, even during the deprivation of the Eucharist. From another view, who is able to separate us from Christ and his Church in communion, in approaching its altars by faith, in a much more efficacious manner, since it is spiritual and further from the sense. It is what I call communicating spiritually, in uniting oneself with the faithful who are able to do it in different places on the earth. You were familiar with this sort of communion in the times when you were able to go to the Holy Table. You knew the advantages and the manner of it, so I will not discuss it with you now, but I'm going to show you what Holy Scripture and the annals of the Church offer in reflections on the deprivation of the Mass and the necessity of a continual sacrifice for the faithful in times of persecution. Give particular attention, my children, to the principles I'm going to recall. They are for your edification. Nothing happens without the will of God. Whether we have a worship that allows us to assist at Mass or that we be deprived of it, let us submit to his holy will, but in all circumstances, let us be worthy. The worship that we owe to Christ depends on the assistance that he gives us and the necessity we have of his help. This worship outlines for us our duties as isolated faithful, just as it outlined for us before in the public exercise of our religion. As children of God, according to the witness of Saints Peter and John, we participated in the priesthood of Jesus Christ to offer prayers and promises. If we are not entitled to sacrifice on visible altars, we are not without offering, since we can offer it in worship by our love in sacrificing Christ ourselves to his Father on the invisible altar of our hearts. Faithful to this principle, we shall gather all the graces that we would have been able to gather had we been able to assist at the holy sacrifice of the Mass. Charity unites us to all the faithful of the universe who offer this divine sacrifice or who assist at it. If we lack a material altar and sensible species, there are no longer any in heaven where Jesus Christ is offered in the most perfect manner. Yes, my children, the faithful who are without priests offer their sacrifice without temple, without minister, and without anything sensible. It needs only Jesus Christ to offer it. For the sacrifice of the heart, where the victim must be consumed by the fire of love for the Holy Ghost, it requires to be united to Jesus Christ, said Saint Clement of Alexandria, by words, by deed, and by heart. We are united to him by words when they are true, by our actions when they are just, by our hearts when charity inflames them. So let us speak the truth, follow nothing but the truth, love nothing but the truth. Then we shall render to God the glory that is his due. When we are true in our words, just in our actions, and submit to God in our desires and thoughts, in speaking for him alone, in praising him for his gifts, in humiliating ourselves for our sins, we offer God an agreeable sacrifice, and that cannot be taken from us. It remains for me to consider the Eucharist as a last sacrament. You could be deprived of it at death, so I must enlighten you and caution you against so terrible a deprivation. God, who loves and protects us, wishes to give us his body at the approach of death, to take away our fear on this last journey. When you look to the future and see yourself on your deathbed, without the last sacrament, without extreme unction, and without any help on the part of the ministers of the Lord, you see yourself abandoned in the most sad and terrible way. Console yourselves, my children, in the trust you have in God. This tender Father will pour on you his graces, his blessings, and his mercies in these awful moments that you fear, in more abundance than if you were being assisted by his ministers, of whom you've been deprived only because you wouldn't abandon him yourself. The abandonment and forsakenness that we fear for ourselves resembles that of the Savior on the cross when he said to his Father, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? Ah, how constructive and consoling are these words. Your pains and abandonment lead you to your glorious destiny in ending your life like Jesus ended his. Jesus, in his sufferings, his abandonment, and his death, was in most intimate union with his Father. In your pains and abandonment, be to him likewise united, and let your last sigh be like his, that God's will be done. Being deprived of extreme unction and in the hands of persons who not only do not help but insult me, I shall be much happier that my death shall have more conformity with that of Jesus, who was a spectacle of opprobrium to all the world. Crucified by the hand of his enemies, he was treated like a thief and died between two thieves. He was wisdom itself and was taken for an idiot. He was truth and he was taken for a cheat and deceiver. The Pharisees and scribes triumphed over him and in his presence. They were finally sated with his blood. Christ died in the most shameful infamy of torture and excruciating pains of the cross. Christians, If your last moments and death are an occasion for your enemies to treat you with insults and disgrace, what were those of Jesus? I'm not sure that the angel who was sent to make up for the hard-heartedness and callousness of men was not to teach us that in similar circumstances, we receive the consolation of heaven when that of men is missing. It was not without a special plan of God that the apostles who ought to have consoled Jesus remained in a deep sleep. So the faithful should not be surprised to find himself without a priest in his last moments. Jesus reproached his apostles that they slept, but he did not say that they left him without consolation to teach us that if we go into the Garden of Olives, if we climb up to Calvary, if we die alone and without human help, God watches over us, consoles us, and for us that suffices. Faithful, you are afraid of what follows the present time. Lift your eyes up to Jesus. Keep them on him. Contemplate him. He is your model. After having contemplated on Jesus, would you still fear the deprivation of prayers and ceremonies of the church that was established to sanctify and honor our last moments, our death and burial? Remember that the cause for which we suffer and die gives to this deprivation a new glory and gives to us the merit of the last bit of resemblance we can have to Jesus Christ. Providence has wished and permitted for our instruction that the Pharisees should put guards at the sepulchre to guard the body of Jesus crucified. It has even wished that after his death, his body should remain in the hands of his enemies, and that in order to teach us that however long the domination of our enemies might be, we must suffer it with patience and pray for them. Saint Ignatius, the martyr, who had so much ardor to be eaten by wild beasts, did not he prefer to have them for a sepulcher than the most beautiful mausoleum? Even the first Christians who were delivered to the executioner, all the confessors and all the martyrs, never worried about their last moments, nor their graves. None of them worried on what should become of their bodies. Yes, my children, when one has trusted Jesus Christ all his life, he still trusts him after his death. Jesus on the cross and near to death saw the women who had followed him from Galilee. His mother and Mary Magdalene and his beloved apostles were near the cross in sorrow, silence, and grief. There, my children, is the picture you shall see. Most Christians feel sorry for those among the faithful who find themselves persecuted, but they keep themselves apart, while some, like the mother of Jesus, go to the innocent which wickedness strikes down. I remark with Saint Ambrose that Jesus' mother, who stayed at the foot of the cross, knew that her son was dying for the redemption of mankind, and wishing to die with him for the accomplishment of this great work. She did not fear to annoy the Jews with her presence and desiring to die with her son. When you see someone die, all forsaken, my children, or by the sword of persecution, imitate the mother of Jesus and not the women who had followed him from Galilee but kept back at the foot of the cross. Be pierced with this truth, that the most glorious and salutary time to die is when virtue is strongest in our heart. One must never fear for a friend of Jesus Christ when he's suffering. Help him, even by our looks and our tears. That, my children, is what I believe I had to tell you. I believe it's sufficient to answer your questions and calm your fears. I have put the principles without going into detail, which appears useless. Your reflections will certainly make up for it, and our conversations, if Providence ever permits, shall be on what you've done and what will inspire you to new desires. I must tell you, my children, not to worry at what you are witnessing. Faith is not allied to these terrors. The number of the elect was always small. Only fear that God does not reproach you for lack of faith and for not having been able to watch an hour with him. I admit, however, that humanity can grieve, but in so saying, I shall add that faith must gladden. God does all. Bear this judgment, It is the only one worthy of you. The unbelievers themselves delivered this judgment when the Savior was making miraculous cures. What he is doing now is far greater. In his mortal life, he cured the body, but now he cures souls and completes by trials the number of the elect. Whatever God's plans are for us, let us adore the depth of his judgments and put all our confidence in him. If he wishes to deliver us, the time is near. Everything turns against us. Our friends oppress us. Our relations treat us like strangers. The faithful who used to worship with us are turned away with a single look. They fear to say that not only unlike us, they are faithful to their country and submit to its laws, right or wrong, and also claim to be faithful to God. They fear to say that they love us or even know us. If we are without help alongside men, we are assured of God's help, who, according to the prophet King, will deliver the poor from the powerful and the weak who have no help. The universe is the work of God. He reigns over it, and every happening is according to the plans of his providence. When we believe that desertion is going to be general, we forget that a little faith is enough to give faith to the family of Jesus. Like a little leaven makes all the dough rise. These extraordinary events, where the mob wields the axe to undermine the work of God, serve marvelously to show his omnipotence. In every country will be seen what the people of God saw. When the Lord was wanted by Gideon to show his power against the Midianites, he had him send back most of his army. Only 300 men remained, and those without arms, in order that it could be seen that the victory was God's. This small number of Gideon's soldiers is the number of the faithful elect of that century. You've seen with the saddest astonishment, my children, that out of all those called, since all of France was Christian, the greater part, like in Gideon's army, remained weak, timid, and fearing to lose their temporal interests. God sends them back for use in his justice. God only wants those who give themselves to him entirely. Do not be surprised at the great number who quit. Truth wins, no matter how small the number of those who love and remain attached to him. For my part, I have only one wish, the desire of St. Paul. As a child of the church, as a soldier of Christ, I wish to die under his standard. If you have the works of St. Cyprian, read them, my dear children. One must go back to the first centuries of the church to find worthy examples to serve as a model. It is in these holy books and in those of the first defenders of the faith that one must form a precise idea of the object of martyrdom and of the confession of Jesus Christ. It is truth and justice. These are the august, eternal, and unchangeable objects of the faith which one must confess. It is the gospel. For human instructions, however wise they may be, they are temporary and changeable. But the gospel and the law of God holds for eternity. It is in thinking over this distinction that you will clearly see what is Caesar's and what is God's. As by the example of Christ, you must render to one with respect and to the other that is his due. Every century, the church is in agreement that there is nothing more glorious and holy than to confess the name of Jesus Christ. But remember, my dear children, that to confess it in a manner worthy of the crown that we desire, it is during the time one suffers most that one must have the greatest holiness. I can find nothing more beautiful than the words of St. Cyprian when he praises all the Christian virtues in the confessors of Jesus Christ. You have always observed, he says to them, the command of the Lord with a severity worthy of your firmness. You have conserved simplicity and innocence, charity and concord, modesty and humility. You have carried out your ministry with care and exactitude. You have been vigilant to help those who need help, to have compassion for the poor, of constance in defending the truth and discipline, in order that there be nothing wanting in these great examples of virtue that you have till now given. It is by your confession and generous sufferings that you highly animate your brethren to martyrdom and to show them the road. I hope, children, although God does not call you to martyrdom, nor to a distressing confession of his name, to be able to speak to you one day, as in the example of this illustrious martyr, when he spoke to the confessors Salarius and Arius, and to praise in you your humility rather than your steadfastness, and to glorify you more for your holiness than for your sufferings and wounds. In looking towards this happy moment, profit from my advice, and sustain yourselves by my example, if necessary. God watches over us. Our hope is justified. He shows us either the persecution stops, or the persecution will be our crown. In the alternative of one or the other, I see the accomplishment of our destiny. Let God's will be done, since in whatever manner he delivers us, his eternal mercies pour into us. I end, my dear children, in embracing you and praying to God for you, as my faith and as my sincere resignation to have no other will but that of God. May the Holy Family of Jesus, Mary, and Saint Joseph obtain for you a perfect love of God, true contrition for your sins, and the grace of final perseverance. Ora pro nobis.